Hello everyone, my name is Shahin, and welcome to an introduction to multi-objective problems. This introduction is intended for everyone, especially those who are interested in learning about something new. Because of this, I'm going to try to explain everything in plain English. Sometimes I'll use terminology which is specific to the field. In these cases, I'll offer synonyms on screen so you don't have to look up the word. Of course, you'll benefit from watching the previous video on an introduction to evolutionary algorithms. The video you're watching now will also lead on to the next video on multi-objective evolutionary algorithms. On screen, you'll see the presentation overview. First, we'll briefly cover what a single objective problem is. Afterwards, we'll introduce the main topic of this video, which is multi-objective problems. Then, we'll discuss some of the challenges which multi-objective problems introduce. We'll then conclude with some recommendations for further reading. In the last video, we went through a single generation of an evolutionary algorithm. This was applied to a problem involving stick figures. As a reminder, our problem was finding a stick figure which could complete the track from beginning to end. This track had a hurdle in the middle, and our stick figure received a fitness score depending on how far it could make it. Each solution to the problem was made up of variables, which we referred to as genes. Here is a look at what a solution might look like. You can see it's made up of variables defining the lengths of a stick figure's limbs and the size of its head. The stick figure would run along the track and be scored on how far it could make it. This problem is what we refer to as a single objective problem. This is because we're only looking to optimize a single score. In this case, it's the distance traveled by the stick figure. The best solution to a single objective problem would simply be the solution with the highest fitness score. Because this is a single objective problem, with these five different solutions, it's simple to say that solution B is the best. This is because it has the highest fitness score. Another term for the fitness score of a solution is the objective value of a solution. To be clear, here you can see solution B has travelled to 350 on the track. For this solution, we can state the following. Solution B has a fitness score of 350. Or, solution B has an objective value of 350. It's important to know this when moving from single objective problems to multi-objective problems. There are also many different terms to describe the solution's variables as well. Some of these are genes, variables, or parameters. It depends on your background and what approach you're using to the optimization. For example, all the following mean the same thing. Each solution is made up of 6 variables. Each chromosome is made up of 6 genes. Each solution is defined by 6 parameters. Let's have a look at another example of a single objective problem. Assume we have a single objective problem where we are optimizing the speed of a vehicle. The process would not require much involvement from an engineer. We would simply run the optimization process, pick the vehicle with the highest objective value, in this case, the highest speed, and offer it to an engineer as a solution to the problem. However, in the real world, we know that designing a vehicle with the single objective of getting the fastest speed possible is not a good idea. This is because, whilst the vehicle may be extremely fast, it would likely have poor ride comfort, have poor handling, be expensive, be fuel inefficient, be extremely unsafe, and so on. This is where we can see that the majority of real-world problems are actually multi-objective problems. A multi-objective problem is simply a problem which has multiple objectives. Using the earlier example, we may want to optimize the design of a vehicle with the following objectives: speed, ride comfort, handling, price, fuel efficiency, and safety. We would refer to this as a six-objective problem because there are six objectives that we wish to optimize at the same time. As part of our problem definition, we can refer to each objective by a number, giving us objective 1 through to objective 6. Here you can see these have been labeled on screen. So what does this mean for our solutions? Each solution now has six objective values, indicating how well it performs for each of our objectives. This introduces many difficulties, but the most significant difficulty is how we decide when one solution is better than another. Let's compare two populations of solutions, one to a single objective problem and one to a multi-objective problem. Our single objective problem will be looking for a vehicle with only the fastest speed. Our multi-objective problem will be looking for a vehicle with the fastest speed and the best handling. This is a multi-objective problem. With the single objective problem on the left, it's obvious which one is the best solution. It's simply the solution with the best objective value. Now look at the multi-objective problem. Which one is the best? If we pick the solution which has the best value for objective 1, you can see it doesn't have the best value for objective 2. Then if we pick the solution with the best value for objective 2, we can see it doesn't have the best value for objective 1. In this case, neither solution is better than the other. Let's plot the population of solutions to the multi-objective problem for a better look. This is called a plot of the objective space, because we are plotting the objective values for each vehicle. Here we can see each glowing marker on the plot represents the objective values of solutions in our population. These have been labeled appropriately. On the x-axis, we have the speed of a vehicle. This means the further to the right a marker is, the faster the vehicle is. On the y-axis, we have the handling of a vehicle. This means the higher up a marker is, the better the handling is. After plotting these points, solution C stands out from the rest. It has a very low speed of 10 and a mediocre handling of 40. But what matters is that there are other solutions in the population which are better than solution C in both speed and handling. Let's have a closer look at this to see what I mean. Here, I have shaded in all of the objective space which is worse than solution B. This is referred to as the objective space which is dominated by solution B. And we can see that solution C is dominated by solution B. Already at this point, we can choose to get rid of solution C. It doesn't offer anything which solution B doesn't do better. But let's continue. Here, I've done the same for solution E. We can see that it also dominates solution C. Moving on to solution A, we can see it still dominates solution C. It matches solution C in handling, but it offers much better speed. On to our final comparison, we can see solution D does not dominate solution C. But the same is true for the reverse. Solution C does not dominate solution D. We refer to these two solutions as being non-dominated, because solution C has better handling than solution D, and solution D has better speed than solution C. However, because at least one solution dominates solution C, we can get rid of it from the population. This leaves us with four solutions. Now, if we shade in the area of the objective space which all remaining solutions dominate, we can see that no solutions are inside the shaded area. This means that all remaining solutions are non-dominated. So, which of these solutions is the best? The answer is, we don't know. No solution completely dominates another, so no solution is completely better than another, unless we have some existing information about some decision maker's preferences. For example, we may know the decision maker will not accept a vehicle design which offers handling lower than 40. Ultimately, we have to present this population of solutions to an expert. This is so they can make an informed decision using their knowledge of the problem. There are many approaches to reducing population sizes by selecting solutions based on some scheme, but these will still not tell you which solution is the best. This makes the selection stage of any optimization process very challenging, because at this point we need to select some solutions which we feel are the best to move on to the next stage of the process. In future videos, I'll cover some popular approaches to selection for multi-objective problems. Another challenge for multi-objective problems is how we visualize the objective space. For two objective problems, like the one we just used as an example, we can use a two-dimensional scatter plot. And this makes sense when we look at it. We can see how far a solution is from another, and easily see if one dominates another. However, what if we want three objectives? We can use a three-dimensional scatter plot. Here, we can still see how far solutions are from each other and if one dominates another. It's just a bit harder to see. Now, what if we want four objectives or more? This is where it begins to get very difficult. One popular way to visualize solutions which have four objectives or more is using parallel coordinate plots. Each line represents a different solution. And going from left to right, each vertical black line is measuring the objective values from objective 1 to objective 4. However, it's now very difficult to see what solutions dominate another, and how close they are to each other in the objective space. This is an ongoing and interesting challenge in the field of multi-objective problems. I hope you've enjoyed this introduction to multi-objective problems. For further reading, I recommend the following book and journals in the context of evolutionary computation. Of course, you're welcome to read my publications, which can be found through my website. Also, I'll be posting regular information using my Twitter account. Thank you for watching. I hope you found it helpful. If you'd like to suggest a topic for my next video or offer any feedback, please leave a comment.